Welcome, everybody. I'm David Scobie, the Dean of the New School for Public Engagement. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you here to tonight's talk by Professor Manuel Castells on the global financial crisis of 2008-12 and the response from the grassroots, alternative economic cultures, and social movements. This talk is sponsored by the Milano School for International Affairs Management and Urban Policy within our division, and I want to give a special thanks to my colleague Lisa Servon for organizing it. It's also part of a larger visit that Professor Castells has made to the New School, organized by my colleagues Gustav Peebles, Cameron Tonkinwise, and Emanuela Castano, and supported by a grant from the Office of the Provost, and I want to thank all of them for helping to make this possible. And finally, thanks to my colleague, Director of Programs for the New School for Public Engagement, Pam Tillis, for her always capable and unflappable skill at organizing events. You all know how exciting a visitor Manuel Castells is, and in that sense, he needs no or very little introduction from me. And I'm also not one to typically plumb the depths of a distinguished visitor's resume. But in this case, I wanted to list some of Professor Castells' affiliations and appointments to give you a sense of just why he needs no introduction from us. He's got a doctorate in sociology and taught sociology at both the University of Paris and the University of California at Berkeley, where he also taught on the faculty of city and regional planning. In 2003, he joined the faculty of the University of Southern California, where he holds the Wallis Annenberg Chair of Communication, Technology, and Society in the Annenberg School there, and at the same time helped to found the USC Center for Public Diplomacy. As the range of these affiliations makes clear, he's simply one of the most wide-ranging, interdisciplinary, and influential social scientists and social theorists writing in the world, and he's been widely recognized and honored for his work, not least with an honorary degree from the New School in 2005 and as the Levin Lecturer in our Milano School in 2007. But if you'll forgive me one more personal note, I would say that as an urbanist myself and a historian of New York, I've been in the thrall of Manuel Castells' work since I was a graduate student in the 1980s and first came upon his books, The Urban Question and The City and the Grassroots, when I was fumbling toward a dissertation about urbanism and city building, space and power in New York City in the 19th century. My somewhat skeptical dissertation advisor, an eminent labor historian, was trying to get me to make him understand what the project was, and I showed him some of the work of Manuel Castells and David Harvey and other of this kind of emerging field, or at least emerging to me, in urban geography and the sociology of urban space. And I remember distinctly him saying, "Now I get it. Space is politics." And so I went on to write a book about New York City that tried to tell the tale about of which space was politics. Since then, much of what I know about urban social movements, networked cities, global information regimes was open to me by reading Manuel Castells' work. This year, the world has seen a vast global outdoor experiment about the relationship between space and politics, or more specifically, the relationship between urban space and social movements and flows of capital and information and the contesting of power in Cairo and Tunis and Spain and, of course, in Wall Street and many other places. I can't imagine anyone better to help us understand and engage the financial crisis and the countervailing movements it spawned than Manuel Castells. Join me in welcoming him.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you, Dean, for your kind words and interest. I am going to follow the advice of my colleague and old friend, Lisa Cervon, who asked me basically to renew the contact with the new school, which is really, to some extent, one of the universities I'm personally linked in the world, through her, but also through a long history of connections and collaborations. And she asked me to update what I'm doing lately in terms of my current research. And that's what I'm going to do. I have always been very disciplined, Lisa, you know that. Anything you tell me goes. But my recent research is, in fact, three research projects which are interconnected. First of all, I started in 2008 to conduct a network of analysts and researchers in around the world, Europe, the United States, Latin America, China, on the roots and consequences of the financial crisis, which now came to an end last November, and it's going to be published in June in a collective volume that it's titled Aftermath, the Cultures of the Economic Crisis. And I will say a word about what that means, this title, and why the focus on culture. Second, I have been working on ways under which people from the grassroots construct or reconstruct their lives as far away as possible within their constraints from the logic of the financial system, in terms of loans, in terms of the work they have to do to pay these loans, in terms of how they construct their lives under the priesthood of bankers. And that we started in 2009 with a research group at the Open University of Catalonia in Barcelona, in the research institute of that university. And this is a group of five researchers, including Lisa Cervon, that we imported to Barcelona for a year to work on these issues. And that's what also I'm going to try to present. And this is, on the one hand, one part of the volume on the cultures of the economic crisis, the aftermath volume. It's a big chapter there that we wrote with Lisa and other collaborators. Liana Liebig, Johanna Kunil, and Amalia Cardenas. And then it's also a book that is being finished in June, and finished, not published, on these alternative economic cultures based on an empirical study of Catalonia, book whose title is Another Life is Possible, Alternative Economic Cultures in a Time of Crisis. And then from the last year or so, I was probably struck, as many of you, with by the rise of urban and social movements, because they were urban, which were at the same time networked social movements based on the internet, both things at the same time. And it's something that I had been investigating for quite a while, a link to my analysis of the transformation of power relations by the transformation of communication, in the book Communication Power that I published in 2009, and in which I presented a number of empirical analyses on Madrid, on several countries in the world, showing how mobile communication and the internet were changing completely the logic and the culture and the possibilities of social movements that always had been a movement centered on the capacity to build autonomy vis-a-vis the institutions of society in terms of government and in terms of corporations on the basis of autonomous networks of communication among themselves and in relationship to the society. So, and that research has led to my latest book that was titled, I think, says everything, Networks of Outrage and Hope, which will be published in September by Polity Press. that's my recent research. So now, of course, I cannot talk even briefly about three books at the same time. So I will concentrate on the newest one, which is the one on network social movements. But I want to establish the analytical connection between the three levels of the study and of the research. What I would say is that, first of all, the economic crisis as such has deep cultural roots. It's not simply a global financial crisis. To start with, it's not global. It's not global. It has global consequences, but it's not global. Most of Latin America is growing. There's no big deal with the financial system in places like Brazil or South Africa or China. So it is interesting. It's the crisis of global financial capitalism, whose core is in the United States and in Western Europe. And that's where the direct impact on societies and on the economies of societies, it's happening the other way around. In fact, some of my Brazilian friends in private say they are very happy to finally see a big crisis in the United States and Brazil is doing okay. They can stop the destruction of Amazonia, but that's a different matter. Therefore, one of the things that has revealed why we titled the book The Culture of Economic Crisis, because really we show in that book what we talk about, when we talk about the aftermath, is not indicating that the crisis has ended. On the contrary, the crisis is unfolding and accelerating as the Greeks. But at the same time, what is happening is that a new landscape of capitalism, I'm not saying something else, of capitalism as such, is being created in this process. To a large extent, very much like the landscape after the Great Depression of the 1930s and World War II, that in usher in a new type of capitalism that then, after the crisis of the 1970s, usher in to deregulation, liberalization, privatization, and abdication of the role of government in most of the world, actually regulating the deregulation, that created another form of ultra laissez-faire capitalism, which is the one that we had been living through, and which is the one that in cultural and institutional terms has largely collapsed. It doesn't mean that capitalism has collapsed, that particular model of capitalism has. And that model and that financial crisis is being adjusted on a basis which is increasingly unsustainable, because basically what governments did was to refloat capital, so the return of the state. The state had disappeared in that world. There was no state. The states were irrelevant. And suddenly, without the state, we would have had a complete immediate collapse of the entire financial economy. So the state saved the financial institutions, the bank, the system, but at the same time, the states all over, in the United States and in Europe, to do so, they committed the public resources to save the financial institutions. And therefore, to obtain the resources, as you know, well, I go very fast because that's not the center of my talk today, but fundamentally, they did two things. Cut the spending, that is, putting the crisis on people's lives, and second, even cutting spending, indebting themselves even more. So through public debt and spending cuts, both things at the same time. By the way, very little tax cuts, very little tax increase, which is exactly what could have been the possible solution. Therefore, revealing to some extent the class nature of the state policies that were included, even in the United States with the Obama campaign, with all the hopes. One, you get into the White House, the system is so complex, someone told me from the high levels of the administration, that to do something to save the system, you need people from the system, therefore you need people from Wall Street, and the people from Wall Street come into the cabinet, but not exempt of values. Even if they are well-intentioned, they know Wall Street, but also they carry with them the values of Wall Street. And therefore, the culture of Wall Street, the culture of Wall Street, and the culture of financial institutions has permeated all the government policies that had been undertaken to fix financial capitalism. And in the case of Europe, against all economic analysis, Merkel insists that to save Europe, Europe needs austerity, first of all. That's not an economic policy. It's an ideology underlying the economic policy. It's a culture, again. It's a culture of German austerity. We are Germans. You see, we don't spend. We just work. That's a culture, which actually does not coincide with the Germans. That's why Merkel today would lose the election. That's why the Pirate Party in Germany is at 10% of the vote and the Green at 15% of the vote. So, in other words, the system exhausts itself, both for economic reasons, but exhausts the values that were transmitting throughout the system in terms of the legitimacy of this global financial system to be able to solve all our problems at the same time. The consequence of that was when, from a financial crisis to a economic crisis, unemployment, et cetera, to then a debt crisis, to then a fiscal crisis of the state, back to O'Connor 75. Under such conditions, another major crisis that was rampant was dramatically enhanced. The crisis of political legitimacy. The data are there. Two-thirds of citizens in the world, including the United States and in Europe, don't trust their government, don't trust their politicians, don't trust their political parties, and they don't trust the solutions that are being proposed. So it's a crisis of crisis management in terms of the crisis of legitimacy. So here, the conditions then under which most of the countries of the most of the people in the advanced countries are today is, on the one hand, their lives entirely dependent on a financial basis are shaken, and the trust in the institutions, the banks, and in the political institutions, government, parliament, etc., has disappeared. No trust. So both crises at the same time. Under such conditions, what is the first risk? There is not such a thing as social vacuum. First of all, if people don't have tools, they don't have instruments to respond, that's why I titled Grassroots Response to the Crisis, then they try to build their own lives, their own life. They don't disappear. Maybe they cannot consume, they cannot produce, they don't have jobs, but they do not disappear. Even if in Spain at this point is 50% youth unemployment, 50%, and 25% general unemployment, these unemployed people don't vanish, they're there. And the crisis has been already going on for some time. So when we look at the development of the crisis, we look and analyze the impossibility through traditional economic policies to restart the engine, we saw that in 2009, now everybody agrees, everybody looks at the situation in Spain and the rest of Europe, then we try to look at what people do under such conditions. And the first thing we found is that many people had already been removing themselves from this mechanism and trying to build alternative economic practices, understanding by such consumer cooperatives, some producer cooperatives, barter networks, social currency, alternative financing, alternative forms of payment, urban farming, the whole list of practices that you know, because they're also in New York and they're also around the world. They're somewhat invisible, but they are there. So what we did is using our contacts to study in terms of ethnographic observation and interviewing, we studied these so-called alternative economic practices in which, let's say, profit is not there and is really use value, let's say, and no basic exchange value. And we found at least about 40,000 people in Catalonia involved in these kind of practices in different networks. And they had started way before the crisis, in about 2003, 2004. Some of them, but not most of them, had been in the anti-globalization movement, and they have withdrawn from that movement with a very strong criticism of the movement itself, and then collapse, saying, well, we are reconstructing another revolutionary left, enough. The revolutionary left ends up being political parties like the others, and with the same ideology, the same dogmatism, and equally corrupt at one point. That's why no one trusts them. So they have withdrawn, but not withdrawn at the same time. They have made, to simplify, a major statement. We are not going to wait to make the revolution to change our life. We are going to change our life. And when we understand how we can make the revolution, we'll do it. But in the meantime, we're not going to sit here and wait for the revolution to come, writing left-wing propaganda. So we found all these people. And we found that they were engaged in a very deep debate. This debate started to be increasingly influential as the crisis showed to the other segments of the population that the traditional ways of living were not there anymore. So then we did, in addition to analyzing these networks with their agreement, we did actually traditional social science, a survey on a representative sample of the population of Barcelona by asking basically them a list of 26 practices that we had identified in the more conscious group, and how much of these practices were in their life. Now, not in the majority of their life, but in their life. Well, we found that a sizable proportion of the population, between 24% and 60%, depending upon practices, were doing that. All these strange things that only neo-hippies were supposed to do. And of course, all were normal people with jobs. And actually, those who live in this network also, they're very normal people. They have half-time jobs, part-time jobs, unemployment insurance, and then do other things to enjoy life, not to the revolution. Then we found this in the population of Barcelona at large. Which kind of practices, you would say? Well, for instance, just one example. Over almost half, about 40-something percent, of the population of Barcelona had, during the time of crisis, lend money to non-family people without charging interest. Well, that's a non-capitalist practice, and it goes directly into finance, meaning financial solidarity, and then hoping, of course, you will give me something back when I have a problem. So then, of course, barter networks, picking up things from the street to use it, massive urban farming, tomatoes, not potatoes. I was telling yesterday to my friends here. The main thing was really tomatoes and vegetables and everything. So in other words, we found a very extensive network. On average, we found that 88% of the population were doing something, let's get weird from the point of view of the capitalist logic. And on average, each person was doing about four of these practices. So then we did a more sophisticated statistical analysis with all the econometric methods, et cetera, and that's what I presented yesterday at the school. And to simplify, we found in these practices, in the population at large, through cluster analysis and correspondence analysis, we found two cultures, different, statistically differentiated. What I would call the culture of survival, that is, practices that were linked to economic survival because you need it, and the culture of social transformation, the culture that was based in looking for better social relations with richer life, and ultimately we decided to call it the culture of the meaning of life, searching for the meaning of life. So both cultures are in most people, but they are clearly differentiated. And in fact, they mix in the practice of people, but they are two cultures. And Now, thinking historically, right, then we always find any major process of social transformation is the connection between people who need it and people who want it. The kingdom of necessity and the kingdom of freedom, right, in the classical terms. When these two cultures, I cannot take it anymore because I have to survive, and I'm bored to death, I want a different life. When these two cultures coincide, that is the beginning of a transformative process, when it's done on a mass scale. And there comes a movement. In Spain and in all the other countries in the world, of course, including Occupy New York, which is the combination of both things, a response to the economic crisis, but not simply to restore the same stupid conditions of living, but let's take advantage of that to change life, and not simply to restore the level of consumption in the economy, and very consciously. How? Huh? We don't know. But since we don't know, let's start discussing. And we start discussing on the internet and in the urban space. And that's why Occupy is not simply a symbolic attack to anything, it's just finding a place to meet. And to meet and discuss over the long term. So, empirically speaking, many of the people that we detected in these networks of economic, alternative economic practices in Barcelona were in the movement, were among the initiators of the movement. So they were in withdrawal from society to some extent in cultural terms, in total withdrawal of the political system, no trust in anyone, not certainly not in the unions, but not apolitical, extremely political from a different kind of politics. And they jump on the opportunity when spontaneously the movement started. Now, then let's go into the analysis of this movement. One last minute information. What is the health of the Spanish movement that everybody was expecting to be death at this point? It's the anniversary of the 15th of May movement. So the movement called, together with movements around the world, including Occupy USA, Inter-Occupy, which is what I call Occupy USA, a global demonstration on May 12th. That was a success in cities around the world. And in Spain, the new conservative government in Madrid and the nationalist government in Catalonia, they said, no, you are not going to camp again. You may demonstrate, but then go home to sleep quietly. And say, no, we will occupy. Not forever. For the time being, we occupy for 3 days until May 15th. The police said, absolutely not. The movement said, absolutely yes, but we'll take care that would be no violence. I don't go into the detail, we can discuss later. Result, the movement has demonstrated, and in Barcelona were about 100,000 people, in Madrid about 60,000, and were demonstrations in 80 Spanish cities, and they occupied for 3 days. And was minimal violence. And if you want to understand why, we can discuss it, because that was one of the key elements in the movement, and I will say it in a moment, is to avoid violence. Fundamental point. Because violence is the way to delegitimate the movement in the 99%. And the whole battle within the movement is to isolate the small group of the Black Bloc and similar, and assert the possibility of a peaceful civil disobedience as a way to overcome the provocations that the police is doing in every country. The moment they cannot avoid violence, they are finished. Until now, the Spanish movement has been for 1 year and has been in all kinds of situations. Violence has been extremely limited, usually linked to police action, and usually acknowledged as such as provocation by the large majority of the public opinion according to the opinion polls. Now, let me take a more analytical look, now I made the connection between the three elements, and report in synthesis what I have found in my research for the last year throughout the world in terms of the Occupy-like movements or indignant-like movements in Spain, which I included the Arab revolutions because it started there. Because of many different similarities, of course, the issues, the discussions are not the same, but ultimately the morphology of the movements, the goals of the movement were quite similar, because as I will say in a moment, the movements all over the world, although many of them have roots in the economic crisis, although many of them incorporate all kinds of economic and social demands, are fundamentally political, be it to bring down the dictatorship of Mubarak or to restart the political engine with a political class which, as a whole, is considered corrupt and not reliable. So these are political movements of a different kind of politics. They are not apolitical movements. That's empirical. It's not my opinion. That's certainly what the movements everywhere say about themselves. So how we know that these movements are, to some extent, similar, and which are the characteristics? I did a series of studies, of course, in Spain. I observed by myself, and I did revolutionary tourism around a number of countries, and I gave a talk at Occupy London, another Occupy Amsterdam, and so on. We did a good chunk of research in Spain. But at the same time, my luck in life is that I have a very good network of former students, of good research collaborators in different countries, certainly Barcelona and Los Angeles, my two places. Many people in the movement accept to talk to me or to my collaborators in depth. So I have very substantial empirical information. I will not go into the details. There's a book there that you can ultimately buy, steal, download. You will find your way. And it's not long. Wow, it's not long for the first time. First time I write under 400 pages in my entire life. That was a requirement of my friend John Thompson, the owner of Polity Press. I said, well, you have to write this movement short and quick. No. Short and quick? Me? Have you seen me? No, but you have to contribute to the movement by doing something short and quick, because now we need it, not in 10 years from now on, with all your references and statistics. So that's the short and quick movement, that book that I wrote about the movement. So what did I find? Well, by the way, also the Arab Revolution, I had a fantastic research collaborator in Los Angeles who is a journalist of Al Jazeera, who was present everywhere, went everywhere, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, I don't speak Arabic, but she is Arab, so. Now, which are the common characteristics? Oh, first of all, when I was convinced that the movement has some common DNA, is by looking where they started as major movements, transformative movements. Remember, Iceland and Tunisia. Can you imagine two more different cultural institutional systems than Iceland and Tunisia? And when you compare that, my first chapter, they are morphologically very similar. And by the way, they are the two movements that clearly were transformative in the political terms. Completely turned upside down the Icelandic institutional system and the banks, and sent to trial the prime minister, sent to jail the bankers. Remember in Inside Job, this wonderful documentary that starts on the financial collapse of Iceland? Well, this is the second part, you see, that the Icelandic people, the oldest democracy in Europe, by the way, and a constitution inspired at this point, like the new one, by the Corsican constitution that was written by Jean-Jacques Rousseau and inspired directly the American constitution, you see? How democracy reinvents itself. these people in Iceland have reconstructed democracy with a grassroots movement with the same characteristics that all the others. You can get this, and then Tunisia. Tunisia that, yes, Islamic government, but moderate Islamists. Ghanoushi, I used to know him in the 1970s, is a democratic Islamist, quite clearly. Very moderate, actually very moderate, too moderate to some extent. But this is now a consolidated institutional democracy that is working. Egypt is not working, but Tunisia is working. So first thing, why these movements could be so similar? Well, if I focus on the features, on the defining characteristics that I find in all these movements, here is my shopping list. First of all, of course, they are network. This is critical, absolutely critical. They are network in terms of internet, they are network in terms of mobile communication, but they are network in multimodal networking morphology. They are physically network. They are networks of friends, they are urban networks, they are social networks in the city. In the case of the Egyptian revolution, key networks were the soccer networks or the soccer fan clubs, absolutely critical. That, of course, they were not on the internet, although they have, everybody has an internet expression. All of you have an internet expression, right? Everything that happens in this planet has an internet expression. No internet expression with a digital divide. The poor people don't have, come on. In the case, first this has been empirically studied and the revolutions were used over the internet, et cetera, et cetera. But any statistics on average simply are lies, don't represent reality. Because of course in Egypt there are only 25% of people with access to internet. But where in Egypt? Because if we take the segment of the population of Alexandria and Cairo between 16 and 35 is 65% access to the internet. And these are the people who really mobilize and who really can change. It's not like the entire population. When we talk about income inequality, when we talk about access to technology, we should get the 100% of the population, no question about that. And everything else is inequality. But when we talk about social mobilization, social transformation, it's not the battalions of the 100% that go. Yes, we refer to the 99%, but it's not the 99% that is going to mobilize from one day to another. It goes by concentric circles, starting not with a vanguard, but starting with the people who they are most or don't have children. That's basically the point. So there are networks within the movement, with other movements in the world, immediately with the internet blogosphere, with the media, and with society at large. Constant networks in the movement. Now, first of all. Second, now, the fact that they are networks create a decentered structure which has two, protects against two dangers. The danger of repression, because there's no center, not command and control center. You cannot deactivate the movement. You cannot capture the leader. You can capture the first one who goes into the street, but not the leaders, because you cannot capture what doesn't exist, no leaders. In some cases, there are some spoke people. In the case of the Indignadas movement in Spain, not even that, totally forbidden. Everybody has to go in terms of his or her own self-representation. By the way, a very important thing, all these movements in the West, not in the Arab world, are not gender. They are explicitly anti-patriarchal in all cases. Actually, the name of the Spanish movement is the Indignadas movement, not Indignados, no generic in that sense. In the Arab revolutions, it's interesting, patriarchal is there, is that the women participated as actively as men. But of course, men tried to occupy the positions of leadership and even repress women demonstrating for their rights within Tahrir Square. Okay? So it's a different situation there. But in the movements at large, there's fundamentally degendering as a general policy. Second, the second consequence of the dissenter structure not only protects against repression, but protects against a much greater danger, the self-destruction of the movement by internal fighting. Because if you are dissenter, if you are a network, then you're not going to try to occupy the central committee or the executive committee, but because they simply is disconnected from the rest, and that's it. And that's the greatest dangers of all social movements throughout history is themselves, the self-destruction capacity of any social movement. So if it is amorphous, has no morphology, yes, it's not very effective. It takes a long time. You cannot really organize the assault to the Winter Palace with a network of this kind. But at least you don't do bad things, which is already a very important thing in the process of the transformation. Second thing, while they form always in the internet, the formative stage is always in the internet, they become a movement by occupying urban space systematically to create visibility, to attract people who are not necessarily in the internet networks, not because they don't have access, but they are not used to organizing in Facebook. And it's in the urban space that they are formed as movements. But, and also that is a direct challenge to the institutions of the state. But they never disappear from the internet, and therefore they create a hybrid space between cyberspace and urban space, in which the urban space component expands or retracts depending on the levels of repression, but never disappears. And that's what I call, they create a third space, a third type of space, the space of autonomy. Why autonomy? Because they cannot be dislodged from the internet. They always can keep communicating, but when they are occupying, they also create networks of communication through the internet and social networks. And if they are dislodged of one place, they go to another, they change tactics, they wait, as the movement all in the Northern Hemisphere have waited for the spring. You know, all this debate in the movement about we'll come back in the spring. Even some of the New York people who I talk to say, you know, Occupy in New York in winter. It's good that they threw us out of Zuccotti Park, because to stay there in the middle of New York winter was going to be a serious problem. Some of them went to Los Angeles, that's where I met them, just because of the climate. Although immediately I say, well, no, a real revolutionary should not be prone to the weather conditions. And then I told them a very interesting story. I think it was in March, in the capital of the Altai Mountains in Siberia, which is near the Himalaya and is one of the poorest regions in Russia, a very corrupt governor, there was a movement, an Occupy movement, in a 200,000 people town. But yes, it was freezing, you know, minus 30 centigrades. But they occupy. How do they occupy? They occupy with hundreds of plastic toys planted in the main square of the city with a banner, each one of them with a different banner denouncing this person. So the Russian authorities were very upset. And they said, no, we cannot tolerate this, because, first of all, the toys do not have constitutional rights. Moreover, most of them are foreign toys, should not be here. So my point is that the imagination and the creativity of the movements everywhere, once you start, finds ways that even in some cases can brave the terrible weather conditions. Third, movements are local and global at the same time, systematically. This famous notion about are we global, are we local? No, they're both global and local. They are local because if they are not local, they cannot relate to the specific problems, populations, etc., but they are clearly global in the sense that they have a global consciousness of being working at the same time in their, not only in their country, in their city, in their neighborhood, and at the same time, globally, connected to all the other movements in the world, because this movement has been viral, has diffused over the internet. I know the people who were in July in discussing in Madrid with people from the United States and people from Adbusters at the moment. The first call came for Occupy Wall Street on September 17th. That was cooked up there, but not cooked up in the sense of a conspiracy. You know, simply you think that you could do something because in Spain the movement is stalled at this point. And that was the idea, coming from a meeting and then went over the internet. But of course, if you don't connect it, if you don't connect with the message doesn't get diffused. So it's both things. But the movements are vital. In the last week in Barcelona, when they occupied the Plaza Catalunya, the main square of Barcelona, very symbolically, they divided the square in four different sites. One was called Iceland, another was called Tahrir Square, another was called Liberty Square, and another was called Puerta del Sol Madrid. So much for the opposition between Barcelona and Madrid. No, when it comes football, yes, because Real Madrid is a terrible soccer team. But in terms of the actual connection to the movement, absolutely no problem. Everybody recognizes that the Madrid movement is deeper and larger and more creative than any other movement in Spain and probably in Europe. So they are local and global at the same time, and they are conscious of that, and they try to embrace the problems of humanity at large. In terms of their genesis, fourth characteristic, they are all spontaneous in their origin. Spontaneous doesn't mean that someone didn't have one idea first. There's always some. But the spontaneous means that there was very little organization, almost no organization, in many cases, sometimes simply a call, as clearly in the case of the Arab revolutions. And they are, in most cases, they are usually triggered by the spark of indignation, of outrage. It's a spark that something happens that then goes over the internet. Was the self-immolation in Tunisia, but also in Egypt. That's what people sometimes don't remember, that in Egypt it started also a wave of self-immolations, and then a woman went on the internet and say, look guys, are you shameless or what? We are having self-immolation, we are Egyptians, and we cannot do like the Tunisians, and that little call is credited for having started the movement. Of course, the woman had been an activist of the April 6 movement in 2008, but was a 26-year-old student and had no real organization. It was just a spark that lighted the prayer. Movements are viral, following the logic of the internet networks. Anything that starts goes on and is being discussed, replicated, forwarded, etc. But then, start from outrage, but the transition from what I call outrage to hope, that is to the possibility of transforming something, takes place through deliberation in the space of autonomy. The space of autonomy is this space, mixed space between cyberspace and occupied space. It needs the occupied space, among other things, because one way in a non-organized movement of joining the movement without signing a membership card or supporting a program is a very easy way. You go there, period. And you are part of the movement because you are there. And no one asks you anything or there's no border there. Of course, this is creates all kind of tensions, complications, etc. But eliminates one of the things which always has been decisive in history. It eliminates the obedience to the party line. And if you don't have party line, or the party line can be ignored because no one knows what the party line is, then anyone can join the movement. Otherwise, the movement is simply a replication of the same system of political division that they are trying to criticize. So Again, all these are characteristics that I struck from the self-representation and practice of the movement. Once they are in the urban space, they create not community, because community would be sharing values. And there are no sharing of, necessarily sharing of values in the movement. Some people agree with some not, but they create something different, which is togetherness. Togetherness. The Spanish movement, one of the key issues of the slogan was Juntas Podemos, in feminine. Together we can. Even Obama knew this when he was not, again, captured by Wall Street. So it's this togetherness is very important for something that I will not go into the detail, but for you that to know, that's in my book, Communication Power. For the social psychology mechanism of social movement, and actually for the neuroemotional mechanism. These movements are emotional, fundamentally emotional. They start because people cannot take it any longer, either because of one event or because an accumulation of things in terms of the cynicism of the political class, what happens in the economic crisis. Now, they're emotional in the following sense, and this is documented. The most paralyzing emotion in human mind is the oldest one and the most important one, fear. These neuroscientists have mapped out the whole thing. When I have some doubt, I go to my friend Antonio Damasio, and he explains to me then very simple terms. Don't repeat anything but this, okay? But why fear? Very simple. It's evolutionary theory. Those who were courageous and didn't run fast enough were eaten up. So we are all the heirs of cowards. The courageous ones were exterminated by different dangers. You know, it's pure evolutionary theory. So on the one hand, it's a very survival strategy to be afraid, to be scared to death. It's a very good survival strategy. On the other hand, to overcome fear, complicated. And societies live based on fear, not on enthusiasm, not on hope, on fear. If I do that, I lose my job, what happened? If I do that, then my family will be in a problem. That's how societies reproduce, through fear. How experimentally fear is overcome? By outrage. When you are so outraged that you don't care anymore, okay, kill me if you want, but I cannot take it anymore. Well, this kill me you want is a sentence that has been repeated in Arab revolution after another. Kill me if you want means I don't care anymore. I cannot take it and I go. And then fear is overcome individually by outrage, but if you go into the street and then you go home in the night, say, oh, what did I do? It's going to be terrible tomorrow. But togetherness in the protected space of the occupy means I am shaking. What about you? I'm shaking too. So let's shake together. And particularly when the riot police come, and particularly when you know that you are going to be arrested. But if you are with your friends and people who are becoming your friends, and you share the danger, and you share that, then among other things, they verify the neuroscientific theory about the matter, but more importantly, it works. Because togetherness creates solidarity, horizontal networking, and reciprocal support. This is, in fact, an old history of social movements. The occupation of urban space is a absolute constant in the history of social movements. The barricades. The barricades were never a military defense mechanism. On the contrary, they become a target. You know, if you build a barricade and you hide behind the barricade, either the cavalry or the cannons get you. But it's a different thing. A barricade creates an in and out. You are within the barricade space, you are part. We are together. you are out, then in fact, you are in danger. You are in danger if you are part of the movement but outside the barricades. There are all kinds of interesting reports on the Tahrir Square in which people say, particularly important, don't go out of the square, keep occupying. That's what, in different points in time, there were up to 2 million people in Tahrir Square or throughout the movement. Because if you go out and you go home, then they get you. See? Extremely important to remain with your together people. They are highly self-reflective movements. They are always thinking about who they are, how they got there, what should be done, which are the mechanisms of creating new participatory democracy. They're constantly interrogating themselves. Ultimately, it would be like great universities if we would reproduce this mechanism to have students and faculty all the time saying, well, rather than giving assignments, let's think about the assignment. You know, so highly self-reflective movements. From the beginning, the movements at large, and that's important, they were and they have tried to be non-violent. Non-violent. Very constantly non-violent. Now, this is very difficult. And there have been heated debates in the movement, and there are different levels. Among other things, it's difficult because part of the movement, it's minimal part of the movement, decide that they have to confront the system, the black bloc, for instance, but also because there are provocations. The whole history of provocation and social movement by the political police is there. And also because sometimes people cannot take any more being pepper gas or being beaten for no reason. Particularly dramatic is the case of the Arab Revolution that started always as democratic, nonviolent movement. And in many cases, and I will not go into detail, but we can discuss later if you want, they, of course, degenerated in violent confrontations and that degenerated then in two things, in civil wars and geopolitical confrontations. The moment you have a civil war plus a geopolitical confrontation, there is no movement anymore. There is no social transformation. It's the traditional thing of some elites killing other elites, coming to power and reproducing the same mechanism. So one of the ways of non-productive historical death of social movements is by getting transformed into a civil war or a revolutionary takeover or a violent geopolitical confrontation. The Libyan revolution, at one point, the Western power decided, hey, Libyan oil too important for Europe, too important. Let's go there and make a nice, quick civil war and then take those who we can manipulate better and let's intervene. Syria has been a case of incredible heroic resistance of the population for more than 7 months. They were being killed by the thousand, and they were peaceful, and they were resisting, and again into the streets, until someone was fed up and decided to arm themselves against Assad. No, until Jordan started to train mercenaries paid by Saudi Arabia, and Saudi Arabia decided that that was a key moment to contradict Iran in the battle for hegemony in the Middle East that Saudi Arabia and Iran are doing. And then the thing is being transformed, not entirely, but it's being transformed. In other words, the moment geopolitical powers come in, movement die. And that's one of the most dramatic things of what has happened in the world. Then, another characteristic, movements are rarely programmatic movements. They don't have a program. They don't have a program. This I look very, very carefully. The declaration of Occupy Wall Street in New York has a fantastic program. About, I counted, about 189 proposals, very specific, to solve every possible problem in the country and in the world. Great, it's a great imagination of the world, but that's not a program, right? It's a projective test of all the things that people would like to happen if they could do it. And it's a banner to mobilize the movement around those issues. Why is not they don't have a program. There are two reasons. One is what I said before. If you have a program, you create a dividing line. Becomes a political party, political strategy, and then you are going to vote for this or not. So reproduces the political system that is being opposed. Second, and more important, the process is what matters for most movements. The way you actually generate goals and specific policy targets, the way you do it is more important than the content of the proposals. Because if the proposals ultimately go into another form of non-representative democracy, in which a few leaders take the proposal and negotiate with the government, etc., regardless of the content of the proposal, the power relationships have not changed, and the forms of democratic participation have not changed. And there, that's the real debate in the movement. In Spain, recently, when the movement restarted, was a very critical moment in which some people, good faith people in the movement, decided to create an association, a non-profit association, recognized by the Minister of Interior, and create a platform around that. So basically, sort of a political party. And then the movement, most of the movement started to say, no, this is not what we wanted, this is already going into the traditional politics, etc., and they rejected. But then another group in the movement imposed finally the fundamental notion. Why not? This is a movement, not a party. If they want to do something different and is not against the goals of the movement, why not? Everybody can do something. You can immolate yourself. You can create a political party. You can occupy and you can keep deliberating in until democracy is truly assured. It's all this at the same time. But therefore, there's no unified program. There's no unified strategy, which makes very unhappy, of course, all the traditional groups of radical left who had been rejected again and again by the movement, because everybody is there trying to fish to go into the Congress to be elected. Without them, they would not have been elected. Well, this guy is a very major leader in the historical Communist Party and the trade union, but he promised, I will not follow the party line. I will follow whatever I see debated in the movement. And yesterday he made a rousing speech calling the Spanish politicians the caste at the service of the banking elites. Never in the parliament anyone had said that. And of course this beginning of starting a connection is what the movement wanted to construct. But ultimately, the issue of the so what? All this great romantic movement, but so what? Well, the so what has different translations. First, what is the impact on the electoral system, on the elections, on the democratic process? It depends on countries. None of these movements has a political position about voting for a party or for another. In the United States, the surveys that we have say that most of them would ultimately vote for Obama, while knowing that many of them are refugees from the Obama campaign. But there are also people from the Tea Party who went to the Occupy movement, where the Tea Party became basically the Republican Party, one faction of the Republican Party. So many came, to, particularly in New York, came to the Occupy movement. So it's a diverse connection to the political system, but fundamentally, overall, there is deep distrust. The most direct connection has been in Italy. In Italy, in terms of the municipal elections and in terms of the transformation of the Italian politics, throwing out Berlusconi, has been through some connection between the Partito Democratico and the movement, particularly at the local level in places like Milan, like Torino, like Napoli, and lately in Genoa and in Parma. In which Beppe Grillo, the comedian, and his five-star movement are now controlling the local elections. So there are many different possibilities. In the case of Spain, as you know, the most direct impact of the movement was to destroy the Socialist Party. And people say they don't care because the Socialist Party started austerity, changed the Spanish constitution under the instructions of Merkel, so why to die and defend for the Socialist Party? But now both parties, conservative and socialist, are at a low point in terms of the public opinion to vote. Between the two of them, they don't go beyond 50% of the voting intention. So it's a crisis of the political system. It's deepening the crisis of legitimacy. Second element, the transformation of the practice of politics by doing it, the process. And that's the most important thing. People say the process is more important than the product. We are transforming politics by doing a different kind of politics. That's the process. And this transformation of the process takes a long time. So, and why to rush? Actually, here is a connection with a very interesting cultural movement, which Lisa is expert of, and I know some colleagues here are, Cheetah Slow movement. The movement wants deliberately to be slow, and actually criticize the acceleration of time and what they call the productivistic ideology of politics. If you're in politics to produce something quickly, well, there are lots of people with lots of proposals, lots of parliament. Let them do all this work. In some cases it's useful, but it's not us. Us is something different. It's rethinking the whole thing from the bottom up. That's the discourse of the movement, of most of them. And the process is more important than the problem. And the process takes time to reach something. The most popular slogan for the Spanish movement in general, in all the occupied, was and is, we are slow because we go far. And you cannot solve all these problems in a few months. Let's work on it. Now, the last week, they started to be more precise to start the actual reform of the electoral law. That's one of my forms of participation in the movement. I wrote the proposal for the reform of the electoral law because without that, elections will always produce the same results in the United States as well, by the way. So they are now going into the proposal stage. So it's not true that they don't care about policy, ultimately. But they care more about the way to propose policy, the process of creating new alternative policies that are rooted in the consensus of people and that they are able to ultimately transform the political landscape and the policy landscape. What else this movement is producing in general? Well, in a number of Arab countries, the political systems have been completely changed already. We can discuss about the consequences, but certainly they have produced major political impacts. In Iceland, they have produced major political impacts, and they are producing a number of indirect political impacts in the formal political process. They had been overwhelmingly supported at the beginning by public opinion, and in the most global poll, which is a Ipsos Gallup poll that at the beginning of 2012, of 23 countries that were polled, only in one country, the people, Japan, more people opposed the movement than supported the movement, but in all the other 22 countries, more people supported the movement than rejected the movement. Although, of course, the largest chunk is people who don't have an opinion because they don't know what to do. In Spain, has been consistently over 75% public support throughout the movement. And even when you ask people the actual occupy, physical space occupy form in countries at large, the majority of people say no. Physical occupation, no, if it is illegal, etc. But still, about on average, 25%, including the United States, say it's okay because we agree with the goals of the movement. In other words, there is quite important support, which in some cases is not the majority of the people, but is more than those that oppose, and in other cases is clearly the majority of the people. They have made an impact on the way people look at society. In the United States, two examples, the motto of the 99%. The 99% discussion now is a normal discussion. Who was thinking about the 99%? And people start to dig statistics, and now they're debating, oh, no. It's the 1% only control 40%, not 50% of the wealth. Huh, really? So it has been a mass discussion on income inequality and its roots and consequences in this country that was not there before. And for me, a more important indicator is the following. According to the Pew research that was done last year, about 2/3 of Americans think that there is conflict between rich and poor, class conflict. 2/3. The proportion in 1967, the first time the question was asked, was about 1/3. The proportion 10 years ago was less than 40%. In other words, at the level of the consciousness has been a relative transformation in most countries, including the United States, of the perception of the issues of inequality, political illegitimacy, political non-reliability of the political class. Again, the data are there, you can check it out. But there's also something else. The ideas of this movement, as all social movements, go through the most indirect channels to ultimately reach an impact on society. And I will illustrate with one example. Sounds like not serious, but I think it is. And I will go to the basic document to read it to you. Take one little piece. It's so, this is a post, March 2012, by Kristen Wynn from Alternet, but in fact reproducing the a press report from the one of the main Mexican international press agencies, SPD. And I read it. I read the report. The largest trade association in Madrid, Spain, for luxury escorts has gone on a general and indefinite strike on sexual services for bankers until they go back to providing credit to Spanish families, small and medium-sized enterprises, and companies. It all started with one of the ladies who forced one of her clients to grant a line credit and a loan simply by halting her sexual services until, quote, he fulfills his responsibility to society. The trade association spokeswoman praised their success by stressing how the government and the Bank of Spain have previously failed to adjust the credit flow. We are the only ones with a real ability to pressure the sector, she started. We have been on a strike for 3 days now, and we don't think they can withstand much more. The woman quoted above says bankers are desperate for sex services and have become so pitiful they are unsuccessfully pretending to have other careers. And they have even asked the government for help. Now, the Minister of Economy, Luis de Guindos, reportedly told the Mexican agency, which broke the story, that the escort industry's lack of regulation makes government intervention difficult. In fact, there has not been a formal communication of the strike, he said. The escorts are making use of the right of admission or denying entry to, well, you know. So no one can negotiate, making it clear that sex is a valuable tool, and refusing it sends a very strong direct message. Well, this is a particularly poignant and interesting and funny story, but it simply tries to illustrate the many, many, many ways in which all these ideas, all this shaking of trust is filtering society. And in that sense, it connects what I have been trying to develop for a number of years in terms of analysis, that the actual power struggles take place in the minds of the people. It's a slow process, but if the minds of the people change, it's no parliament, no political class, no electoral law, and no police that ultimately can prevail. Thank you for your attention.
Questions and comments, and let me simply ask to wait until you have a microphone after Professor Castells calls on you so that we can continue recording the whole conversation.
Hi. So how do you see the situation now in Greece and France after the elections? And do you think that, depending on how the situation in the European Union is going to evolve and with the euro, do you think, like the you mentioned the civil war or something, like when the extremes get in collision?
Well, actually, I can answer. Thank you. Well, in I have been working a little bit on Greece. One of my main research systems is Greek. Now, the situation in Greece is that 66% of the Greek people refuse the austerity package, which is signed by all relevant parties until now in Greece. So they already impose to the socialist, they, meaning the European Union, under Merkel's leadership for that particular case, they impose the rejection they impose the austerity package by rejecting the referendum that the Prime Minister of Greece, socialists wanted to have. So they basically threw him out, and the right wing of the Socialist Party, Venizelos, came to power in the Socialist Parties to simply make an alliance with the Conservatives. You know that. But why I am mentioning this, which is well-known fact? Because at that time, one of the key things in which they forced election was the outrage in Greece, but also throughout Europe, by the proposal by Merkel and Sarkozy to create sort of a proconsul from the European Commission that would go in Greece to oversee the budget of the Greek government, meaning intervening the country. Now, the backlash against this forced elections. Now, elections actually saw the major advance of Syriza, the party that really ran against this package. They could not convince Syriza to go into an alliance with the traditional parties to do the opposite of their program. They convinced Dimar, the left democratic party, that campaigned against the package and then was ready to enter into the government for the package. And they could have made the government. They had the vote for that. But they couldn't morally toward the majority of the Greek population. So new elections, June 17th. The majority of the population continues to be strongly against the austerity package. The opinion polls at this point project Syriza winning the election, not with absolute majority, but with a decisive majority that would block any other attempt. So there is an all-out campaign to terrorize the Greek people of the consequences of rejecting the austerity measure, together with some policies that now Merkel promises, we'll give you money. If you are good and you vote for the people who want the austerity package, we'll give you money. And will not be just austerity, will be less austerity. Well, the problem is, as we know, that Greece, after all this, is at the same level of public, is a much worse level of public debt than 3 years ago. And the projection, if they are good people, is that in 2015, we'll go back at the level of public debt of 2003. So there is no economic solution for Greece under the current parameters. They would have to completely restructure the Greek economy under a huge package of the European Union. But they don't have the money. Because if they do that with Greece, in terms of the Spanish financial system, is in deep crisis. The fourth largest Spanish bank collapsed a week ago, and that was the government bank, basically the Partido Popular bank. And the European Union, and of course the Spanish economy, is five times the size of the Greek economy and the 11th largest economy in the world. So at this point, the current situation is untenable for the Eurozone. And the only attempt with Greece is to make possible to contain the Greek exit from the euro from spreading to other Eurozone countries. That's the only issue that they are really trying to achieve. But financial markets are networks, and they react by spreading information and by going into crowd psychology. So that Greece will remain in the euro is, at this point, Citicorp says 75% no. But that this will end the Eurozone is a big question mark. And the one who is praying for that not to happen is Obama. Because if the Eurozone explodes, then there is a global financial crisis that will hit the United States exactly at the time of the election. I think Romney is acting on that, too.
Thank you for your talk. Very inspiring. I particularly like when you're talking about the creative economy's reaction to the financial crisis, that there are those that come to it out of survival or necessity, and those that come out of the meaning-making or kind of more ideological, aspirational place, and that together at the nexus is where transformation happens. I think we can also look at the Occupy movements in that space. Some people come for survival reasons. The homeless that have been down at Liberty Park saying, we've always been here. The organization Picture the Homeless is one prevalent kind of group that's there out of survival. But I wonder how you respond to the notion that those two different camps or sides also have a tension between them. I've learned from my students here at the New School that some come out of this more meaning-making place. They're excited to be a part of it. And then I have students from the South Bronx and from Harlem who are there who are saying, we're concerned with police brutality, with foreclosure issues. And they actually see a tension between those that come for a more aspirational reason and those out of survival and necessity. Even one comment I heard from some Take Back the Bronx groups, which was the Occupy the Bronx, is that the Occupy Wall Street folks are now colonial occupiers in that they're trying to teach the boroughs how to run a GA. So I just wonder if in your travels and listening you have a response to maybe the tensions between those who come more out of survival and those out of an aspirational place.
I really liked your discussion of rage and overcoming fear. And then, and so there's many nice links, but then to get to her point, how you discuss, I think it was 189 proposals by the Occupy movement, and the sense of rage is not a really good collector of thoughts. It's a good overcomer of something. And then to go to your final point about decisions have, you know, the speed isn't of the essence. But you see what's happening here in this country, and you see what's happening in the euro, and there is no movement. And so some sense of how are things, how, why are you optimistic? You know, you left with a kind of a coda that was, this is all working. I think it's interesting what's happening, but I draw precisely the opposite conclusion. And where do you get your optimism from, which goes, I think, very much to her point.
Okay. Well, first of all, if by optimist you mean policy proposal, no. Of course, in my tone, I recognize the fact that people have reacted against a financial and a political system when no one thought that people would have reacted, and that these movements have a considerable support in the public opinion. This is an observation, and then I try to analyze it. I'm not proposing anything. And in fact, none of my works, none, proposes anything. They're purely analytical. Most people get very furious with that. But among other things, because that, in the case of the Spanish movement where I have been more involved, that would be not a good idea that I start proposing things. It's truly different. It's truly different in terms of the politics. It's the politics of the process, not the politics of the proposal. And to some extent, what people say, it's interesting in terms of the public opinion, people say, we agree with the goals of the movement. We like them. We don't think they're going to change anything. That which personally I don't think, but for my other analysis, that if the minds change, this ultimately will happen. But let me then take the two questions connected. And you are right, they are connected, but they require two different comments. First,
when I refer to a culture of economic necessity, this is expressed in labor demands, in social demands, and there the connection to the unions is the critical one. A different thing is to the intractable social problems of this society, in terms of homelessness, etc. And there is a terrible conundrum for the movement, everywhere. On the one hand, to see occupied spaces full of homeless delegitimizes the movement with 99%. No question about that. On the other hand, none in the movement, anywhere, opposes the presence of the homeless, because that contradicts the very notion of inclusiveness of the movement. That's an empirical observation. I can give you a case. In Amsterdam, the Occupy movement became totally marginal. And Amsterdam is a city of social movements, because it was really taken over by the homeless people. So a homeless people movement is not what this movement everywhere has tried to do, which is, on the contrary, to connect to the values and problems of the mainstream society to the 99%. So it's an internal contradiction between the values of the movement and the image that the movement presents. And no movement has been able to solve that. What I saw in Occupy London, I don't think it really creates a good solution, because in Occupy London, what they did, they created a social service center for the homeless, drug addicts, etc. But that's not the movement either. And then it was highly criticized by other movements, saying, well, you know, you are going to be a charity, this is a different thing. But at the same time, you cannot reproduce the marginalization of the people who are there. And then second, homeless, as you know, there are two types of homeless. People who need psychiatric support and people who simply lost their home. Even in the case of the Occupy Wall Street in New York, some people lost their home because they were occupying. And then they could not make enough money to pay the rent, and then they became homeless when they were already occupying. So that, I have seen an intractable contradiction and very much opposed. Now, about the optimism, again, I'm not optimistic or pessimistic. That's not in my vocabulary, not. My tone of emotional enthusiasm is linked to the fact that in the middle of a major crisis, in which clearly both the financial elites and the political leaders have abused their societies, clearly, in the middle of this political and economic crisis, people thought, well, business as usual. It's going to be a fight between the parties, that one party will try to unseat the other by doing a set of maneuvers, and nothing will happen. Nothing can happen. Well, at least millions of people around the world, the demonstrations in October last year, and not this October particularly, there were really about 15 million people demonstrating in 1952 cities in 85 countries simultaneously, with no organization, just the internet. Why I think it's, there are also examples that it's possible. Now, everything is different. So when you say Iceland, oh, it's Iceland. When you say Tunisia, oh, but the Arabs are different things. And so on and so on. But something is moving in all these societies, and they have a great current of sympathy which don't have bankers, don't have financial elites, don't have business, and don't have politicians. So all the elites in the world, at this point in every country, they are despised by their people. The people who are protesting in confusing terms on their behalf, they are supported. But then what? Simply, very simple. Even if they put some transformation in their minds, there are no institutional channels. There are no institutional channels. The system is blocked there. And you know what now, if you want, not in terms of optimism, but in terms of thinking about what could come, but going back historically, I only predict retroactively. It's much safer. what happened at the end of the 19th century in Europe? There was a moment in which, in a political system organized around the conservative bloc and the liberal bloc, suddenly society changed. Suddenly they were working class women, they were workers, they were anarchists, they were socialists. All kinds of things started to happen. Had no political expression. And therefore, there were social movements versus the state as a consolidated political class. After two decades, the liberals had disappeared or fundamentally transformed in Europe, I'm not talking about the United States in this case. And there was a conservative bloc that included, in some cases, the liberals, and a new bloc of labor parties, socialist parties, social democratic parties that were alternative on behalf of the interest of society. Now, this is what's happening now. Socialist parties are being destroyed in Europe. France, different thing at the last minute. The Socialist Party is destroyed. It's just a mobilization against the Sarkozy policy that could express itself in the presidential election, but it all depends to what happens in the case of Hollande. But why the socialist parties or the liberal parties historically are the ones that are destroyed by this movement? Because conservative parties always represent the same interests, always represent the dominant interests, speaking largely. The parties that are, let's say, on the left of the system, it's a geometric concept, the left of the system are those that, if they do not express the interests of society, the values of new interests that emerge in society have no function. That's exactly what's happened in Spain particularly, or in Greece. If the socialist parties simply are those who support Merkel's austerity policies, then people drop them, you see? So in historical retrospect, one can understand that the left of the system, if it does not respond in some way to some of the demands for the people, then they will not be the left of the system anymore. And to some extent, the United States is what's happening to Obama. For whatever reasons, he did not fulfill the program he was propelled to power to accomplish. And now he's in trouble. The only way for him to survive is going back to the traditional forms of politics now, which is, I dislike this guy more than I dislike this one, which is, as you know well, people vote against, not for. So there we are. There are no bridges between all this social mobilization and cultural transformation and the political system. And this, when it's deep enough, historically we now cannot be sustained for a long time. That was my answer.
We have some questions over here. First you and then. Hi, I was wondering if you came across any details in reference to some of the more alternative sources on the internet indicate that social movements, especially in the Middle East, had also some outside sources of funding, military, economic, you know, sort of these subversive sources of money that also propped up these social movements. Can you talk a little bit about that, or what you found?
Well, frankly, in terms of data that could be reliable, no. In terms of people talking about, certainly in the internet, as you say, but also on the ground, in Egypt, in Libya, in Syria, yes, people talk about all kinds of foreign interventions, conspiracies, etc. And in the case of the Middle East, I think we can safely assume that this is happening, because it's an absolutely critical region in the world, and all the powers in the world are intervening there to defend their turf and their interests, and certainly Israel. But as I said, Iran and Saudi Arabia and Jordan as intermediary for Saudi Arabia. So they are there. However, the movements started autonomously and spontaneously. This we have enough indication that that's the case. But once they started, and once people understood, I mean, the notion that a young woman in Egypt issues a call in the internet, and then less than a month later, Mubarak is gone. No one thought about that. It was unthinkable. So there was no strategy and preparation for this kind of phenomenon. But once the movements are launched, once the movement starts developing, of course there are all kinds of conspiracies, influences, etc., which in some cases in Egypt, the whole thing is to convince the United States that Islamism of any kind is a terrible thing. And then the US doesn't know exactly what to do, actually, because the US supported the massacre in Bahrain and didn't say anything. But in Egypt, played a different role, forced the restoration of the internet and among other things, for the simple reason that experts in the area know, and systematic it has happened. Any free election in the last 10 years in an Arab country, the Islamist parties won. And because that's what the society is about at this point. Because the other alternative, Arab nationalism, fell down, and to vote for a pro-Western, pro-US, but no one is let alone pro-Israeli. So Islamism at large is the political ideology of the Middle East in terms of formal partisan election. The movement itself is not. In Tahrir Square, Christian cops collaborated with Muslims. They actually protected Muslims the day of the prayers. The Christian cops were organizing the protection against security forces. And the heart of the first movement, the young people who started the movement, were not Islamists at all. The Gonim, all these people, particularly the women, were not Islamists, and women were decisive in the case of Egypt. Now, once again, it's like here, once the movement goes into formal politics, they have to relate to the population at large. So the movement transforms the political landscape, democratizes in case of Egypt. Once you go into formal politics, then depends on the play of the political parties in the public opinion. And there, the Islamists have an advantage. And then there are all kinds of conspiracies and alliances in the world. Certainly, we know for sure, in the case of Syria, is major foreign intervention in the movement. When the movement was not repressed to death, 2 months after, now we know there I have information about systematic foreign intervention, including Russia. Remember that Russia, the only military base of Russia outside Russia is in Syria, with Assad.
Okay. When you have a situation like this, where things start to fall apart and center doesn't hold, but it stalls out because you're more concerned with process than you are with policy. The one thing I think is missing in your analysis is the existence of extremist parties out there. And what role do they play? Because if you look at history, you had this in Russia, and then you had Lenin and the Bolsheviks came into a vacuum. You had this in Italy, and you had Mussolini and the fascists came into a vacuum. You had this in Germany, and Hitler and the Nazis coming into a vacuum. So what are the dangers, particularly in Europe, of the extremist parties?
Thank you. Look, I think there is a real danger and not such a real danger. The danger from in Greece, people have exaggerated because of this Nazi group in Greece is absolutely hideous, and but they got less than 7% of the vote, and everybody's talking about them. The traditional Stalinist Greek communists, they got about 9% of the vote, more than that. If you add all the other votes, this is a very minor group. Now, it is a complicated issue to see that such a directly Nazi party emerges in the public opinion and enters into the parliament. But I think much more worrisome is not in Southern Europe, in Spain they are not, because they are in the Conservative Party anyway. So, but the much more serious problem is in Northern Europe. There you have a problem. And yes, you are right, in any situation of economic crisis and political crisis, of the crisis of political legitimacy, in which the parties, the mainstream parties, don't fulfill their responsibility vis-à-vis the population, you have two things going on. Movement, but with no direct political expression. They are trying to reach out to the political system to see if some of the demands go through. And new political forces that come as reaction, and which on the contrary, rather than go forward, go backward. And there you're right. It's, the True Finns already got 21% of the vote last year. The second largest party in Norway is basically a xenophobic party. The Netherlands Wilders is a xenophobic party. And in France, as you know, Le Pen has 13% of the vote. So in that case you are right. It's not that these parties can actually come to power in terms of the election, because then all the other parties would coalesce in the political system, but it's a symptom of the composition of the political system, when the political system cannot translate the demands of the society and the response to a crisis. So there is a danger, certainly. It's not a danger of political takeover, but it's a danger of having a sizable proportion of the population, I would say more than fascist in traditional terms, is a different thing. It's xenophobic and ultra-nationalist and racist. That is more important. So it's not so much against the left or against democratic values per se. It's trying to reach enough power position to intensify xenophobia and racism. And that's on the way. You're absolutely right.
Over on this side.
It would be a source of conflict between all parties when they realize that these public spaces are such important, they can act as important catalysts for public revolution. Thank you.
Well, let me say, for the time being, the movements that I have observed, they have been in the Arab revolution and in the Europe and the United States. There are now new movements emerging more and more in Russia, which is could be an interesting development. In the third world countries, they're not equivalent. There is one example, that's Chile.
With the student movement. But there is a very complicated situation because it's both the Communist Party and a movement. But the one thing that is common is in the entire third world, all political systems and parties are delegitimized. In terms of what people think, what people expect, the notion of corruption, the notion of bureaucracy, the notion of non-representation. In Latin America, in the last decade, this had an expression, chavismo. I mean, all the changes in the political democratic regimes in Latin America came as a populist reaction to the inability of the democratic systems to solve the problems of the people, and in addition, to be totally corrupt. Why Chavez triumphed in Venezuela and still has a very strong basis there, even if he's going to die soon. But why? Simply because the Venezuelan political class probably got the Oscar for the most corrupt political class in the world. That Chavez was there, and then Chavez helped to diffuse the movement in terms of traditional neopopulism. Each one is different. Evo Morales is not the same thing, Correa is not the same thing in Ecuador, but overall, and Uruguay is certainly something different. That was the left-wing reaction that channeled political opposition into that level. But in every country in the world, there's a total, in the third world, there's a total crisis of legitimacy that then is treated in different ways, not through the movements, but through demagogic leaders that engage, in most cases, not Uruguay, that engage in this. Thailand has a little populist revolution every 3 years or so. In other cases, is the military. But the political instability is, in this case, independent of the economic conditions.
Okay, last question.
Thank you. Thank you for all. Very rich by many points of view. I would like to go back to the first part of your speech when you were talking about the grassroots alternative economy. And I totally share with you, for what I did in my research, that there is a new world that is emerging in some way. So even there are all the complicated issues that we have seen now, for I see, as I think you see, that something is happening. Well, I ask you, don't you think that even for the movement, it's totally legitimate, this movement, to have a totally distrust on what the politics institution can do? But us here, for instance, the new school, or I come from Milano, we are intellectual, we have to do something. I think we have to do something. So even if we are not asked, but I think that, for instance, if we take the very specific case, the alternative economies, they can find a more favorable or a less favorable environment. Mm-hmm. I have no time, but I can quote some situation in which the institution can create more favorable environment for that. So in my view, this is a way not to be neutral. So we can, or we should, define some strategies to create condition to make this emerging world to have more possibility to exist and to grow, and afterward, politically, we will see what will happen.
I agree. I think you should do it. no, really. the more people think about something, the better. If you want, in terms of my personal position, is I don't do this in my academic work. I do this as an individual. And I do this always in contact with the people who are the actors of the social movements, not outside. So every time that the movement somewhere has asked me to cooperate with this or that, I do it. But I do it as part of the movement and in debate and interaction with the people in the movement, not as an intellectual from outside that because I have an academic position, I can... and can say a number of things that have some authority, etc. I always. No, I didn't say that. I just say I'm not normative, which is different. I'm not normative in my analysis, which is different. I'm not normative in my analysis because I think the first role of an academic is to be rigorous in the analysis. That's the first role. Otherwise, we're useless. So that's the first role. And then, as a person, as an individual, we do whatever we can in terms of our values. So I'm not neutral, and my analysis is not neutral. It's certainly influenced by my critique of the system, et cetera, et cetera. But the most important thing for me is that what I analyze is rigorous enough so that even the movement can use it. And the movement uses it all the time, but doesn't use my ideas about what to do, but my analysis about what is being done. That's a different thing.
Thank you so much, Manuel Castells. This has been wonderful. Thanks to everyone for coming.